We read in Luke 1 from verse 26 to 38. Now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one, the Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" She meant she has never been with a man sexually. And the angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore also, the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible." Then Mary said, "Behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. On Good Friday, while we watched from Patmos, the Holy Spirit started to talk to me about this ultimate yes. The yes which impacted the whole world. The yes which transformed lives. The most powerful yes of all times. Mary saying, "Let it be to me according to your word." It was the first ultimate yes. And since Good Friday, the Lord started to journey with me about this yes. And tonight, I'm sharing this with you with shaking legs and a shaking heart because of these words, such powerful words. Anyone has said in the word, "Let it be to me according to your word," Mary's words. The example she has said for each one of us to follow. Not for Jesus to be birthed again and again through a virgin, but for Jesus to be birthed spiritually in the spirit of each person who says yes to the price he paid. We read in Galatians 2:20. It's Paul. He writes to the Galatians. He says, "I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Beloved, tonight I want to say to you that God is saying to each one of us, you have found favor. The angel spoke to Mary and he said to Mary, rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women. Tonight he's saying to each one of us, rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women and among men. And then he says, do not be afraid, for you have found favor with God. These are the words, I believe, that echoes from the empty cross and from the empty grave throughout all eternity. Rejoice, highly favored one. Do not be afraid, for the Lord found favor in you. These are the words that the Lord is saying to each one he created. The one who chose to murder and the one who chose to rape, the one who chose to kidnap and the one who chose to abuse, the one who chose to love and the one who chose to serve, each one has been created by God. And God is saying over each one he created, rejoice, highly favored one. And you might wonder, but how can I say that a rapist and a murderer and an adulterer and an abusive person can be highly favored? And the reason why I can say that each one of us and each person created by God is highly favored is because of what happened on the cross. Because John 3:16 teaches us that God so loved the world, meaning each person created in the heart of God. Each person that Ephesians 1 verse 4 tells us was in God's heart even before the beginning of creation. Each person that Jesus paid the highest price for each one. And that is why we are highly favored. And that is why he is saying to us, rejoice, because you have found favor in the eyes of God. And tonight he's saying that to each one of us. And many of us, I believe all of us sitting here tonight, and maybe if you're watching on the live stream, we have said yes to Jesus for the price that he has paid for us on the cross. Without realizing that price was paid because we are highly favored. And that price that has been paid is declaring over our lives that we are the favored ones. That we are highly favored by God. And most of the times we say yes to what Jesus did for us on the cross, but we never think to respond the way that Mary responded. Mary's response was, let it be to me according to your word. How often do we say these words of Mary because we have been favored by God? Let it be to me according to your word. What was the result in Mary's life? Because of this response. Because Mary said, let it be to me according to your word. The impossible happened in her life. Because of her word, she gave birth to Jesus Christ. She gave birth to the source of eternal life. Because of her words, all of us can look forward to eternity with our bridegroom God. She gave birth to the power which overcame death. Because Jesus overcame death, the grave is empty. She gave birth to healing because he is healing. She gave birth to peace because he is peace. She gave birth to salvation because that's what he is. She gave birth to holiness. She gave birth to prophecy. She gave birth to unconditional love. And we can go on and on and on with all the attributes of Jesus because that's what she gave birth to. So Mary was willing to say, let it be to me according to your word, because she knew this word came from God and she knew God. Even though she was but a young girl, engaged, she's never been with a man, yet even though she knew what the consequences will be in the natural for her, being pregnant and not being married, she said, let it be to me according to your word. And because of her obedience, because of her willingness to say these words, salvation came to the world, and salvation came to me, and salvation came to you, to each one of us. The question is tonight that the Holy Spirit asked me was, what can be the result of our lives if we are willing to respond the way that Mary responded to the Word of God? If we will be willing to say, Lord, let it be to me according to your word. Because just as the Holy Spirit came over Mary, resulting in the birth of Jesus, the Holy Spirit is moving in this world to reveal the truth of Jesus as Savior to each one created. And the Holy Spirit is moving upon people to conceive the new birth of Christ in people's spirit. So when we said that very first yes, when we said yes to Jesus to cleanse us with his blood, to save us so that we can become children of God, we responded to the unction of the Holy Spirit, the working of the Holy Spirit from outside. But after that first yes, we must respond to the working of the Holy Spirit from inside of us. Because after the first yes, the Holy Spirit came to take up residence in our spirits. And now he's within us. And now he's unctioning us to respond the way that Mary responded to the word of God. To say, let it be to me according to the word. Can you imagine what our lives will look like? What the lives of believers on this world, in this world, on this earth will look like if believers will start to say, let it be to me according to your word. Can you imagine what this nation that we live in can look like if the 70% who say they are Christians will start to say, let it be to me according to your word? What will happen in this world if we start to say these words? Mike Bigel calls Matthew 5-7 the kingdom lifestyle. I just looked at that. There's so much more in the scriptures that we can look at to see what a life can look like of us when we say, when we are starting to be willing, when we get the boldness to start to say what Mary said, let it be to me according to your word. Then we will be blessed because we will be poor in spirit and we will have the kingdom of heaven. We will be blessed because we will mourn and be comforted. We will be blessed because we will be meek. And because of our meekness, we will inherit the earth. That's the promise in Matthew 5. We will be blessed because we are merciful. And because of our mercifulness, we will obtain mercy. We will be blessed because we will be pure at heart. And because of the fact that we are pure at heart, the word promise that we will see God. When we say, let it be to me according to your word, we start to live the word. And this will be the result. We will see God. We will be blessed because we will be peacemakers. And we will be called sons of God. And because we will be called sons of God, we will walk in the authority of God. And have you seen in the Word what is the outcome of someone walking in the authority of God? Have you read in the Word that when Peter walked past the sick and his shadow fell on the sick, they got healed? His shadow? We will be blessed because we are persecuted for righteousness' sake, and the kingdom of heaven is ours. And we will rejoice and we will be exceedingly glad because we will know that our reward is in heaven. We will walk with joy and gladness in our hearts. We will be the salt of the earth, says the word. And we will season the lives of the people around us. Salt gives taste, wonderful, beautiful taste to food. Food without salt is horrible. And we can be the salt in the lives of the people around us to change and impact their lives. We will be the light of the world, and we will bring light in areas of darkness. We will know that even an angry word against a brother is like murder. And we will stop talking like that to each other. When we bring our gift to the altar, we will be reminded if someone has something against us. And then we will first go to reconcile with that person before we give our gift to the Lord. We will not lust after other people or after things. And we will consider marriage to be sacred. Do you know that the divorce rate of Christians is not different from the divorce rate of non-believers in our nation and worldwide? We will love our enemies. Our yes will be our yes and our no will be our no. And we will turn the other cheek when someone slaps us on the one cheek. And when someone asks us to walk 1 mile with them, we will walk a few miles with them. That's what we will do. We will do good in secret, not to be honored by man for what we are doing. We will live a lifestyle of prayer like Jesus did. Like he taught us, and we will cherish fasting and time in the secret place. We will not gather treasures on earth where moth and rust can destroy it, but we will lay treasures up in heaven where nothing can destroy it. We will guard over our eyes and not allow darkness to fill our eyes. We will spend way less time on screens because of what screens bring to our eyes. We will guard over our eyes. We will not serve two masters, but we will be loyal to God alone. We will be sensitive in our spirits for any idols that might be in our lives. And you know, an idol is anything that we treasure more than God. And maybe we think we don't have idols, then we must just go and check our time. If there's stuff that we spend more time with God, and I'm not meaning working 8 hours a day, the Lord wants you to do, then it doesn't mean if you're not spending another 8 hours with God that your work is an idol. I'm talking about the time outside of that time. What are you doing when you get home? How many hours are you spending with a screen or anything else which is not God? and not his word. That might be an idol. I'm not saying it is, but it might be. We will not worry about our life, about what we shall eat, drink, or wear, because we will know that the Word of God says that worry cannot add anything to our lives. This weekend, we were watching something, and there's a guy, it's not a spiritual, a Christian thing, but there's a guy saying, worry is only negative prayers. But when we say, let it be to me according to your word, we might start to pray more faith prayers instead of negative prayers. We will know that just as God clothed the grass of the field, he will clothe us much more. We will know God is faithful, and we will seek his kingdom and his righteousness first, and know that his promise, when we do that, he will add all the other things to us. We will not judge, and we will not look past the plank in our own eye to find the speck in a brother's eye. We will stop to gossip, and we will stop to speak negative about our brothers and sisters. We will know that we can ask, and it will be given to us. We can knock, and that we can just knock, and the door will be opened to us. We will know how to be careful for wolves in sheep's clothing, and we will be able to know good from evil. We will be able to build our lives' houses on the rock. And we will be able to stay steady in the strongest of storms. This is what the word says. This is how our lives can look when we follow in Mary's footsteps and say, let it be to me according to the word. How is this possible? It's possible when we start to spend time with the Word. When we spend time in the Word becomes our lives. The truth is that the Word becomes alive in us the moment when we said that very first yes. But the question is, have we surrendered like Mary did? Have we surrendered? Are we willing? Are we bold enough to say these words of Mary? Because the invitation is for each one of us every morning when we get up, when we wake up, not to say, where's the coffee, but to say, let it be to me according to your word, Lord, in this day. May my life be according to your word today, Lord. That's the invitation for us. Because Mary said those words, those nine words. We are being considered to be highly favored in God's eyes. Because Mary was bold enough to take that step and to say, let it be to me according to your word. Everything changed for each one of us. And God is inviting us to be bold enough and to be brave enough to start to say these nine words. But just as it was not easy for Mary, I think Josie and Kirsty can give us very first-hand information of how it is to be pregnant for 9 months, to carry a baby, to go through all that discomfort. And then when this baby was born in Mary's life, he was not just an ordinary boy. He was the Son of God, and she knew that. Yet she had to feed him, and she had to clean him, and she had to change his diapers, and I don't think they had diapers that you can just throw away. Nothing was easy. Yet she was willing, because she knew it was the word of God. So to say yes to the word to become alive in our lives might not always be easy, but to say yes to the word of God, we are starting to say yes to God's plans and God's promises over our lives. And the question, therefore, is, do we want to settle for our own plans, our own ideas, what we think might be best? Or do we want to start to say, let it be to me according to your word? Because in Psalm 139, the Lord says that he wrote all of our days in his book, even before we were born. So when we start to say, let it be to me according to your word, we are starting to say to God, God, may your words, the words that you wrote in your book over my life, become my life. May that become my destiny. May that become the place that I am going towards. May that become my lifestyle. May that become my way of living. May that become the things I say. May that become the things I do. And the reality is that that might scare us, because that might perhaps change the course of our lives. If we are to decide tonight to say, let it be to me according to your word, because God's plans for us might be different from what we have decided to do. There might be a course direction, a change in the course of our lives. If we are bold enough and brave enough to say, let it be to me according to your word, Lord, the Lord might come and say, but yes, I want it to be according to my word in your life. Are you willing to resign your job? Are you willing to say no to certain things you are doing? Are you willing to say goodbye to certain friends in your life? Are you willing to start to speak up and to speak out where you are silent? Are you willing to stand up in your workplace and say no to stuff which you know is against my word? Are you willing to go to your Muslim brother, to your Muslim colleague? Are you willing to go to that person and to say the truth to that person in love? Are you willing to not be silent when you are supposed to speak out for the name of Jesus? Are you willing to be persecuted because of that? Or are you going to be satisfied with your own plans, your own dreams, your own direction? It's the question that the Holy Spirit is asking us tonight. Are you willing to say what Mary said? Let it be to me according to your word. And you might be exactly where God wants you to be, because you are journeying with God. So I'm not saying that it's going to be a course direction for everybody, but maybe someone's life, someone must be willing to be able to change if you want to be bold enough to say, let it be to me according to your word. God might want to use you in ministry even though you are still working. You don't have to always resign your work to join in ministry, join the Lord in ministry. Because ministry might be the Lord asking you to get up early on a Tuesday morning and to join in the prayer room interceding for the nations. That might be where God wants to use you. Or God might want to use you in worship. Or God might want to use you to go to the hospital once a week to pray for the sick. If there's an anointing on your life, to pray for healing. Because often God calls people and he speaks to us and he says to us, I want to use you as an instrument to pray for the sick. I want to anoint you to touch the sick so that I can heal them through you. And God might want to ask you to set aside some of your time to go to a hospital and to start to pray for the sick. or to join the healing rooms here at the prayer room, to minister, to pray. Are you willing? Are you bold enough? Are you willing to say what Mary said? Let it be to me according to your word. You might still be in school and God might want you to start a prayer group in school. Are you willing to say, to give up a break during the week, one break, and say we're going to pray for our school? Maybe God wants you to start with an intercession group at your workplace. Are you willing to arrive an hour earlier so that you can gather together with fellow believers to pray for the workplace? There's so many things that might change in our lives when we do what Mary did, when we say, let it be to me according to your word. And when Mary said that, salvation came to the world. Maybe if you say it at your workplace, salvation will come to those at your workplace who's not saved yet, or in your school, or in your family, or in your friendship circle. Salvation might come to those who's going to hell, on their way to hell, because they haven't said yes to Jesus yet. Just maybe salvation might come through us if we start to become willing like Mary to say, let it be to me according to your word. Tonight we're going to spend some time, each one of us, talking to God about this. Are you willing? Ask him, God, what do you want me to do? I want to say this, help me to say like Mary, let it be to me according to your word. So for the, I'm going to ask Petrus and Adrian to come forward so long. For the next about half an hour, I'm inviting you to talk to God, to speak to the Holy Spirit, to allow Jesus to come and stand in front of you and look you in the eye and ask you, will you be willing for me, for my name's sake, to say these words of Mary? Are you willing? Are you willing for the change that might come in your life? And then I want to invite you, because sometimes it's easy to sit in the chair and say it, but if you feel this is what you must do and you are so afraid, I invite you to come forward for someone to pray with you to be able to take that step, to say these words, to be brave enough to stand up out of your chair and to come to the front and to say to one of the full-time staff, students who will be here, please pray with me to become brave enough to say these words. Father, this is not easy to follow in the footsteps of Mary. Because sometimes we are just comfortable where we are. Maybe like Mary was comfortable being engaged to Joseph, still being a young girl, looking forward to her wedding day. Maybe planning already ahead, and suddenly you step into her space. And you say to her, Mary, I want you to become the mother of my son. Are you willing? And suddenly, in that moment, she must have considered the consequences. She must have considered what will happen. What are the people going to say? What's Joseph going to say? She definitely thought, what is Joseph? How can she tell Joseph that she's pregnant? He will think she's been with a man. Father, yet you had so much grace for her. You have sent an angel and you have appeared to Joseph and you spoke to him and you made a way. It was not an easy way, Father. they had to go to Egypt. And she had to give birth to her baby son, to your son, in a stable, in a humble place where it must have been so dusty and so extremely uncomfortable, not having her mother with her to help her, not having anyone with her to help her besides you and Joseph. Father, she must have considered all the consequences, yet she said, let it be to me according to your word. And tonight we ask you, Holy Spirit, will you help us to, like Mary, even though we consider the consequences and even though we might know that the consequences will be so hard, that we will be brave enough and willing to say, let it be to me according to your word. Will you help each one of us as we sit now with you, spend time with you, talk to you about this? Will you help us in this moment to be willing to say these 9 words in Jesus' name?
Oh, to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, in his presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender. Jesus, I surrender, make me Savior, wholly thine. Let me feel thy Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender. Surrender all to thee, all blessed Savior, I surrender all. I surrender all into your hands. Let it be with me according to your word. My Father, only your will for my life. Let my will become yours. Let it be according to your word, my Father. I say yes. I say yes.
I say yes.
I say yes.
I say yes.
I say yes.
To
I say yes.
To your will for my life.
I say yes. I say yes. For every plan in your books, written in heaven over my life. Every plan, every dream you had for me, I say yes, Father. I say yes. I say yes. I say yes.
If there's anyone who needs healing in your bodies, I just feel this in my heart to make an invitation for anyone who needs healing, any form of healing in your bodies, to come forward. And then if you know that the Lord has spoken to you about prayer for healing, I want you to respond, to come to pray for whoever is coming. So I'm just convinced in my heart there is people here who need healing tonight. So just really so hard, so on my heart, and that God wants someone who knows that the Lord is talking to them about prayer for healing to respond, to come and pray. So anyone who's fighting illness in their bodies, it can be a chronic illness, it can be something, please come forward. Also to give those that the Lord wants to use tonight to step up and step out in faith to come and pray for you. So Armin, you're responding to obedience, so you can come, Tani Didi, you're for healing. Okay, you can pray for healing or responding, healing. Okay, so if the Lord is talking to you about praying for the sick, I want you to respond now, to come and pray for people standing here for healing. Ina, you're here to pray for someone, eh? If you are fighting with illness in your body, please come forward. And if you know that the Lord is talking to you about prayer for the sick, you can come and join in to pray for someone. Here's still two people who need prayer for healing. And I know there's more of you here that the Lord wants to use to release His healing power. The second thing I felt in my heart is if you're here tonight and the Lord spoke to you about a direction change in your life, maybe the Lord has called you into ministry many years ago and you haven't responded yet, and you know that somewhere that you are going to have to respond to that call, I want to invite you to come forward so that someone can pray for you. If you know that the Lord has been calling you for full-time ministry or for some kind of ministry, and you are really tonight, you felt the unction of the Holy Spirit to say yes to that, even though it might not mean immediate change, but change will come, I want to invite you to come forward so that someone can pray for you. Really felt in my heart that there's someone who longs just for support and prayer. Mare. Who feels that the Lord lays on your heart to take a step of faith in a specific direction? This is now the time to just step out for someone to pray with you. You might be sitting here and the Lord might lay something on your heart to share with someone else. You please step out and go and share that word. If the Lord has put a word in your heart to share with someone, I invite you to just follow the lead of the Holy Spirit to share with that person that word.
Let your healing flow, Holy Spirit. Healing through your wounds, Jesus. There is healing through your blood. There is healing in your name, Jesus. Be glorified. There is healing in your wounds. There is healing through your blood. There is healing through your name, Jesus. Be glorified. Be glorified.
Feel in my heart that there's someone here, that these words of the angel to Mary, where the angel said to Mary, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. This is now the 6th month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible. Your situation might seem to be impossible. Tonight, God wants to say specifically to you, with Him, nothing will be impossible. He is the one who can, like we sang in this song earlier, make a highway in a sea. He is the one who parted the Red Sea. He is the one who gave water from a rock. He is the one who changed water into wine. He is the one who multiplied food to feed the multitude. He is the one to whom nothing is impossible. And so if you are facing a situation which seems to be absolutely impossible, tonight the Lord wants to say to you, He is the one with whom nothing will be impossible. Nothing is impossible to God.
Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible to the one who believes. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible to the one who believes. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible to the one who believes. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible to the one who believes.
Whatever situation you are facing, the Lord is saying to you tonight, nothing is impossible. Just believe in what He promised, in what He says in His word. Nothing is impossible to the one who believes. Father, I want to thank you for for moving in our hearts tonight with your word and giving us the courage to say, let it be to me according to your word. Will you help us these days that's lying ahead of us, the weeks that come, every day to say, to wake up and to say, to have the boldness to say, to have the willingness to say, let it be to me today according to your word. And Father, if it happens that we didn't say it when we wake up, that we forgot to say it, that maybe we were afraid to say it, I know that you just say, I forgive you, let's try again. And every day is a new beginning. Every day is a fresh start. Even though we didn't say it yesterday, we can wake up tomorrow and say it again and journey with you. Will you help us, Father, in the name of Jesus? And I also ask, Father, in Jesus' name, will you give your angels charge according to all of us as we drive home tonight? Will you keep us safe? Will you guard over us? Will you cover us under your wings? In Jesus' name, amen.